This morning we're going to be talking and teaching out of the book of John, and we're continuing our service series on different people that were at the foot of the cross. They were near Jesus' life at the end, and in your bulletin you should have a handout that looks like something like this. I'm going to give you a little bit of context before we kind of get into the meat of it. Feel free to take notes as you go through. And Dave, if you would mind handing out some Bibles, Dave will put some Bibles out if you need them. Feel free to take them along with you when you go home. We encourage everybody to read along this morning if you can. So what makes you courageous? There are lots of acts of bravery that are out in the world, but something that defines courageous is moving against normal decision-making, like diving into a burning building to save somebody, right? We're trained from when we're very little to be careful of things that are hot and burning. And as we move forward in our lives, we stay away from that kind of stuff. So it might be courageous to go save a child or an animal or whatever it is from a burning building. But there are reasons why we think something is courageous versus something that's not. And Yusu Kawahara was a Japanese Air Force pilot in World War II. Yusu describes two group of men that were kamikaze pilots. These were the suicide bombers that flew into ships and buildings and things like that. You had the Kichiga. These were thought of to be madmen. They were basically into being a kamikaze for the sole purpose of finding personal honor and immortality. Then you had another group of people. They were the Sugupadai, and they were kind of liberators. Their whole focus was that they would be willing to die just for a greater cause, die for the emperor, die for the country, whatever it happened to be. And he asked this question, Yusu asked this question, which is more honorable, those that die for personal gain or those that die for the greater good? And I think it's interesting because Yusu himself was also scheduled to be a kamikaze pilot. His suicide flight was scheduled, and he was all set to die. He fell more into that later class of people, these liberator sort of people, ready to die for the country. And so, as was a custom, Yusu went home for 2 days right before his mission to say goodbye to everybody. Well, on his fateful flight back, the bombing of Hiroshima happened on August 6, 1945, and the war ended. So, ironically, this kamikaze pilot was never able to fulfill his mission. And it left him wondering, was he courageous? Could he be courageous to take on such an endeavor for the country and never be able to fulfill the purpose? Well, I think that it's an interesting thought that he would ask this question because I think it shows a lack of overall understanding on what it means to be courageous. You see, a kamikaze pilot or a suicide bomber, they're not brave, right? And being brave is part of the definition of being courageous. Because they're being duped into sacrificing everything for a lie. You can't be courageous unless it's built on truth. There's no such thing as being courageous or brave and doing this on the premise of a lie. And this is important today as we look at Nicodemus. Nicodemus is somebody who seriously considered the truth. And as he seriously considered the truth, he was able to step out in a very courageous way. It gets down to the very basic essence of what does it mean to step out, and when do you step out in faith, and is that courageous? And when do you step out, and you're just simply stepping out as the kamikaze pilots would for personal fame or the benefit of a country? So let's start with us in John chapter 3, the Gospel of John, chapter 3, and we're going to start in verses 1 through 8. And I'm going to kind of go through this kind of quickly, and I'll pick out a couple of things as we get into this. So let's start with chapter 3, verse 1. John, chapter 3, verse 1. Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, who was a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with them." And Jesus answered him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Well, who's Nicodemus? Nicodemus is a Pharisee. That means he's kind of like a religious guy, right? He's like all over, what does it mean to be religious? And he's really good at it. In fact, Nicodemus, we learn about, he's actually part of the Sanhedrin. And the Sanhedrin, they're not just any group of people that are really good with religion. They're like the cream of the crop. And they were also the leaders of the Jewish religion. So they were very powerful. They're the main ruling bodies. And the way to think about it is this, we kind of have like a Supreme Court here in America, and they're kind of the ruling bodies as respect to the law, and they have a great understanding, and when they say this is the way the law is, that's the way it is for all of us. And when they issue a ruling, we all have to live by that. Well, the same thing it is with the Sanhedrin, right? They are issuing laws, basically, or understandings of the Jewish culture. Now, if I'm Nicodemus, I'm kind of feeling squeamish about this. In fact, it talks about that he went and talked to Jesus by night. Well, if you're issuing the laws and you're going to go talk to somebody who's against the law, it's got to make you feel kind of odd, you know? In fact, it's kind of like you're law-breaking and you're the one who creates the law, you know? Has anybody gotten a speeding ticket? Jenny, okay. That's good, Dave. Lots of people out there. Oh, lots of hands, okay. What happens? What's that feeling that you get when you see the lights go on? Woo! What do you feel like? Your heart stops. You're kind of like down in the seat. Like, you get that. Like, I just kind of feel sick feeling, right? Well, I think the same thing is happening here with Nicodemus. Here he is going to talk to Jesus, and he is being confronted with something completely opposite to what he's teaching. He knows it's wrong. That's why he's going to talk to Jesus at night. He kind of gets that feeling of, oh, what's going on? But yet, he knows that what Jesus is saying, because he references that Jesus is a man of God, he's telling him, well, I know it feels wrong, but it's so right, because what Jesus is saying feels right. And so I think there is this weighty feeling, and there's another experience that we have. If you've been married or have taken a major commitment, when you're standing up on the altar, right, you've kind of had that sick sort of feeling when you're kind of like going down the altar and like things are all spacey, right? I don't know, does anybody else? You know what I'm talking about, right? Like, you're there like, I can't believe this is really happening to me sort of thing. Like, I can't get out of this, right? This is like it, right? What you're pointing at is significance. You're there contemplating the weightiness of the moment because it's so significant. And because it's so significant, you start to think about how big of a commitment this is. And that's what Nicodemus is going to also. So not only does he have that, I'm sort of sick feeling, like, oh man, I really shouldn't be here, but he's contemplating, what does it mean to be saved? Everything he's been taught about, his entire culture. In fact, everything he's been leading, probably he's got to be at least 30 years old. And because he's part of the Sanhedrin, he's probably pushing 50 at this point. That means everything in his entire life for 50 years has been around the type of teaching that he has been pushing to the Jewish society himself. And here he is. He's contemplating the weightiness of, has everything he's been teaching for 50 years been wrong? I mean, it's huge. His entire life is coming into vision. Well, I think that's it's an exciting time as we look through this passage, because Jesus honestly and truthfully encounters Nicodemus and gives him something to think about. Look with me here in verse 4. Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" And Jesus answers Nicodemus. He's not just kind of pushing him off and saying, I'm right, you're wrong. He's giving him legitimate thinking here, but telling him it's something far beyond what Nicodemus has ever contemplated. "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of the water and spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." You see, everything Nicodemus knew was based on works. And Christ is saying you have to be born of the Spirit, something God is going to give to you. "That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I have said this to you, because you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it is, where it comes from, or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Christ is saying to Nicodemus, this isn't about you. It's not about your laws. It's not about the way in which you want to encounter God. It's about where God is at work, where the Spirit blows. See where God is at work. And where God is at work, right? That, when God works in your life, is where you will find salvation. Wow. If you're Nicodemus, everything you've thought about for your entire life has been shaken. Their whole system of works and working together. Nicodemus, he's putting it out completely on the line when he goes to talk to Jesus Christ. He's seriously considering these real challenges. But at first, Nicodemus doesn't take it forward. He contemplates these things. He thinks about it. But he's not ready yet to step out in faith. He's been seriously challenged. And now he's going to be convicted. Let's pray real quick. Our Heavenly Father, Lord and Savior, we're excited, Lord, that you've given us a message this morning. And you've asked us to consider the truth, Lord. And we know that when we understand the truth, we can step out in faith and courageousness, Lord. And Lord, when we do that, we can encounter you in a more real and personal way than we've ever thought. Amen. All right. We're going to push into point one here in your outline. And I think that it's interesting when we look at verse 9, Nicodemus begins to question. But he's not saying no, he's just questioning. Nicodemus said to him, well, how can these things be? I mean, Christ is just presenting, and Nicodemus agrees that Christ is God. So Nicodemus is saying, well, how could God be telling me these things are true? You know, I think so often the truth is in front of us, and we don't really believe it. In fact, you know, it was a Tuesday, and there was a resident of Long Island, and his order had finally arrived. He pulls it out, and it's a barometer. It's a highly scientific barometer that he ordered from a very prominent company. And after inspecting this barometer, he starts knocking on the barometer, and the needle doesn't move. It's stuck to hurricane, right? And he shakes this barometer. Probably not a good thing to do with a highly sensitive instrument. But, you know, the thing's just not working, right? So he writes this real nasty letter. He throws it in the box, puts the whole thing back in the box. The next morning, he takes it, he puts it in the mailbox, and he heads off to work. Well, that was Wednesday. And on his way back, he figured out that the mail probably never got back to the originator, to the sending company, because the mailbox was gone. And not only was the mailbox gone, half the neighborhood in Long Island was gone as well. You see, a 100-mile-an-hour hurricane blew through the city. The East River overflowed 3 blocks inland. There was power outage throughout the entire city as that Category 3 hurricane hit New York City on September 21st, 1938. The hurricane was estimated to have killed 800 people, damaging and destroying over 57,000 homes, and cost the city, in today's money, $4.7 billion. He had the truth in his hand and couldn't believe it. And the same thing is true with Nicodemus and even with us this morning. As we're looking at the scriptures, this is truth. It's truth. There it is. And what do we do with it? You know, it defies logic. We don't understand. In fact, as we go into the next verse, verse 10 here, Jesus answered him, "Are you the teacher of Israel?" I mean, if anybody should understand, it should be a teacher. "And yet you do not understand these things." You know, I don't think Jesus was saying, like, "Nicodemus, you're an idiot." I mean, Nicodemus can't be in the Sanhedrin unless he's really well-versed and probably a really smart guy. The bottom line is he's not willing to believe the witness of Jesus Christ at this point. And not only that, it's not just about Nicodemus not understanding. Christ is beginning to assert or hold Nicodemus accountable for the teachings that he has been moving forward, that he's been promoting. In verse 11, "Truly, truly, I say to you, we speak of what we know and bear witness to what we have seen, but you do not receive our testimony." Who's the we's and the ours? You know, the we's in this case, or you all don't understand. Is he saying, Nicodemus, you all on behalf of the Jewish nation, you all don't get what you've been reading, and what you all have been teaching is wrong. And here's what's right. And now is the time to receive, to understand that teaching. Now, it must be difficult if you're Nicodemus because it's truly an uncommon belief. This is something completely unique. And so it is with us as we understand the teachings of Jesus Christ. "If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe the things I tell you? I tell you heavenly things. No one will ascend into heaven except the one who descends from heaven, the Son of Man. As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, and that whoever believes in him may have eternal life." You know, Christ is pointing at the very fabric of the Jewish faith. He's pointing at something beyond just teaching the law. He's pointing at the actual message of salvation. And this is something that is really hard for Nicodemus to get his arms around. But at least Nicodemus is beginning to think about it. Though he kind of goes on away, and we don't see him for some time a little bit later, at least he's beginning to think about it. You know, the question is Nicodemus going to start building lies for all these non-truths that he believes? An excuse has been defined as the skin of reason stuffed with a lie. An excuse is defined as the skin of reason stuffed with a lie. And Nicodemus no doubt had lots of reasons in his brains not to believe Jesus Christ. And only a coward would be content with those kind of convictions. Because if you are believing things that you believe are absolutely true, but there's no truth behind it, if there's no understanding behind it, it's cowardness. Right? It's easy to go with the pack. It would have been easy for Nicodemus just to dismiss all these folks and say, you know what? This Jesus, I know he's God, but it's so much easier for me to stay in my own little world and believe what I've been taught. And I think what Christ is pointing at is he's saying, look, you need to be courageous. You need to stand for truth no matter how difficult it might be, no matter how sick it makes you in your stomach, no matter how big the commitment. We got to stand for truth. And that's what Nicodemus begins to ponder and think about. As we encounter Nicodemus, moving into our second point, you'll see that he's really contemplating the role of Jesus Christ. And you see him kind of backing off from his old Jewish behaviors here. The next point we see Nicodemus is in chapter 7 in John, a little bit to your right, just a couple of pages. And what you'll see here is Nicodemus is actually being able to internalize these teachings of Jesus Christ. And as he begins to internalize these teachings of Jesus Christ, his outside demeanor, his actions begin to change. And so should ours. Look with me in chapter 7. We're going to look at verse 50 through 52. It says this, "And Nicodemus, who had gone to him before, who was one of them, said to them, 'Does our law judge a man without first giving him a hearing and learning what he does?'" In this passage, what they're talking about is should Jesus Christ be tried or not? You know, there were divisions among the people. Do we believe Jesus or don't we believe Jesus? And what you see is the top ruler of the land who should be coming down hard on Jesus. What's he saying? Boy, I don't know. In fact, what he was saying is he's kind of using a technicality. He's saying, you know what? Boy, I think we should give this Jesus another thought. You actually start to see the truth of Jesus Christ begin to permeate and penetrate Nicodemus's mind. You see, he had not closed off Christ's claims and teachings and the truth, but he's also not really like supporting it. Like, hey, stop! Hey, let's be careful about this Christ. He's God. I mean, we know Nicodemus knows that because he told us earlier. But in this case, at least he's beginning to be open to it, and he's beginning to use his position to say, you know what? Let's think about it. In fact, I think what Nicodemus needs is he just needs a nudge. He just needs to kind of get pushed forward so he can start to understand the teachings of Jesus Christ. There was a cruise liner, and it was in full swing. There were speeches being made, and the captain was talking, you know, and the crew was going out, and the guests were enjoying just basically a nice long voyage. Well, sitting at the head of the table was a 70-year-old man, and he was somewhat embarrassed. He was sitting right next to the captain, and he was doing his best to accept the praises that were being offered to him. And you see, apparently earlier that morning, a young woman had fallen off the ship. And that young man, or that old man, he ended up in the water next to the woman, and they had rescued the woman, and here they were doing a hero's dinner that night, a hero's banquet. And it came time for this courageous man to speak, and the captain gave him the microphone. "So, can you tell us about this little event? Why did you drop in?" And the guy grabs the microphone and he says, "I just want to know one thing. Who pushed me?" You see, the guy wasn't really courageous. The whole foundation for the banquet was based on a premise that the guy actually was courageous, that he was diving in for his own purpose, and he wasn't. The woman had fallen in, and somebody had pushed him in right afterwards, and they both got saved. You know, I think, like that old man, maybe what Nicodemus needs is just a little bit of a nudge. And so do we. You know, when we see the truth out there, sometimes it's just a matter of going a little overboard, and we just need a little nudge. You know, there's always folks that are saying, you can't do this and you can't do that. In fact, as we read on here in John, let's look at verse 51 and 52. Our law does not judge a man without first giving him a hearing and learning what he does. So that was kind of the defense of Jesus. And then verse 52, other people said, are you from Galilee too? I mean, his cohorts are saying, are you insane? We got this guy Jesus. We got him by the neck. We're ready to go crucify the guy. And they're saying, are you from the same hometown that Jesus is? And see that no prophet arises out of Galilee. They're beginning to spout scripture. Well, you know what's interesting? There's always naysayers that say, you can't believe this and you can't believe that and forget this and forget that. You know what's funny is was Jesus born in Galilee? There's a town in Galilee where Jesus is associated with, Jesus of Nazareth. Is that where Jesus was born? No. Jesus was born where? In Bethlehem. Bethlehem is not Galilee. The Pharisees actually had it wrong. And they're saying there can't be a prophet from Galilee. And in fact, we know that's not true. We just finished studying up in the book of Jonah. And Jonah was from Galilee. Right? These guys are they're just like, we don't care what the truth is. We're going to bend it all over the place. We're going to bend the prophecies all over the place to kind of prove our point. And so Nicodemus, he needed some time to look at the deep facts here, but he needed courageousness to step forward and begin to build his own belief system, his thoughts, his premises on truth that were not built on the popular opinion, simple understandings of the Scripture that are taken out of context, but go back to the Scriptures and understanding what is the real truth and being challenged with that. We need a courageous consideration that contradicts the cost. All of his brothers are saying, Nicodemus' brothers are saying, don't do this, don't go there. And no doubt Nicodemus is throwing everything away from a humanly perspective. But he sets the costs aside, and he sets the costs aside. He considers what it would really take to follow Jesus Christ. And you see him kind of stepping out in a little way here. But truth will present itself when we begin to ignore the cost, when we begin to really pursue, honestly pursue Christ. We see the next point where Nicodemus comes in, and this is in chapter 19 in John, and this is at the end. It is at the foot of the cross. And no doubt Nicodemus is near Christ when he dies, but you actually see Nicodemus beginning to really step out in faith. In fact, there's a real reverent action. And why don't we read here in John chapter 19? I'm gonna read this through kind of quickly, and let me explain what's going on here. John chapter 19, and we're going to start in verse 39. And there we go. It says this. So Nicodemus, so this is after they're taking Jesus down off the cross, and they're going to put him in a tomb. Nicodemus also, who had earlier come to Jesus by night, came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes about 75 pounds in weight. Some of your renditions might say 65 or 100 pounds. It's a lot of weight. So they took the body of Jesus and bound it in linen cloths and with spices, as is the burial custom of the Jews. And now in that place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. So because of the Jewish day of preparation, since the tomb was closed at hand, they had laid Jesus there. Well, let me kind of set the whole context. Nicodemus is the ruler of the Jews for all intents and purposes. He begins to side with Jesus, and what do you see? Here he comes in, he's bringing about 75 pounds worth of spices to help with the funeral. Now, we don't deal with funerals the same way, right? In fact, most of us don't like funerals. We don't like being around funerals. We don't even like the whole topic of funerals, right? But, you know, they kind of give you the heebie-jeebies. But back in the day, you got to do something with the body. And so it comes to the family and those that are close to him. So here Nicodemus is, he's got about 75 pounds worth of myrrh. So you got this weight thing. He's got to like hoof this stuff over to the tomb. Well, myrrh was a very fragrant, gummy resin, right? And the Jews used it kind of in a powdery form to kind of pack the body in. So not only is Nicodemus on his way to the tomb with this great big thing, right? He's also got myrrh, which is sticky and smelly. So it's not like he's walking down the street, right? And somebody comes up, hey, Nicodemus, what are you doing? You know, it's like, nothing. You know, ignore me. You're like, you could probably smell it across the street. It was so strong. And he's 50 years old. Not that 50's so old, but he's hoofing a 75-pound
you know, like walking down the street, right? So it's not like Nicodemus is going to be like inconspicuous. And furthermore, they go to a brand new tomb, which is by the cross, and they just had this huge event at the cross, right? So everybody in the world is around where Nicodemus is going to go prepare the body. So he's deeply involved. And then he gets there to this garden location where the new tomb was, right? And people know not only was he involved, but he had to be deeply involved in helping to get the body to the tomb. So there's no mistaking, Nicodemus at this point is like completely open about what he's thinking. Furthermore, they know that the work couldn't continue past 6 o'clock. Why? Because 6 o'clock is the start of the Sabbath. That means this is going on in plain daylight, right? Nicodemus's faith is like wide open. There's no escaping. Wait, hey, what you doing there? Nothing. You know, like you walk up to him. Looks like you got something going on there, you know, and no doubt you got Joseph of Arimathea and a bunch of other folks probably carrying the body of Jesus and putting him in the tomb. Everybody knows what's going on. I mean, this is a really courageous act if you're a Pharisee, and not only just a Pharisee, but a member of the Sanhedrin. This is huge. And so I think Nicodemus was deeply convicted by the cross. He was honestly pursuing a very public, reverent action that could only be associated with deep conviction. You know, it's kind of like we have our Supreme Court that we were talking about earlier. So let's say you had a Supreme Court justice, and what he did is he commissioned the Ten Commandments to be painted in the courtroom as a mural, right? Would that happen? But furthermore, he was going to be reviewing Roe v. Wade, right? Something on abortion. And they go and they try to overthrow the previous ruling. And then after that, he closes the trial with a prayer. And then following that, he goes down on the steps and begins to pick it, right? I mean, this is like the picture of what Nicodemus is doing. I mean, how courageous. He is like taking everything he's ever known, his entire culture, his entire identity, everything for 50 years. And he's like saying, compared to following the truth, I got to set all that other stuff on the side. I mean, how amazing would it be if a Supreme Court justice got Christ and acted out in such a way that it was obvious to everybody what was going on? You know, conviction calls us to a courageous commitment. The question is today is, what would it take for you to be convicted, to be truly courageous in thoughts and belief? You know, it's time, I think, for us to rid ourselves of cowardly vestiges. So often we're like Gulliver. You know, this Gulliver travels. Gulliver, it's a big guy. Actually, he's by these little guys. They're Lilliputans, these little bitty miniature soldiers in Jonathan Swift's story. And they have Gulliver like strapped down to the ground, right? They have all these straps across them. And they can't move. And all he has to do is get up because he's much stronger than little people. And that's the way our lives are so often. We have cowardly vestiges, little things that sit in life that we can't get by. My parents told me this. I was taught this way. And now when I'm presented at the truth, I can't look at it. Or, if I go present the gospel or go to talk to somebody about my faith in Christ, what are they going to say? Right? That's a cowardly vestige. You can't do an evangelistic outreach in West Dallas. I mean, nobody does, let alone talking to strangers. I mean, how many of us did that this last week, right? Those are cowardly vestiges that we need to get rid of, because when our lives are based on the foundation, the premise of Jesus Christ, we can only help but respond to the cross, to live a courageous life. There's two gentlemen, Phil Masters and Stan Dale. Maybe you've heard of these guys. They were missionaries in Indonesia in 1968. And after deep consideration, Phil and Stan decided to go bring the gospel to the cannibalistic tribe, the Yali. And when they landed their plane off a little river, they, as soon as Stan got out, they found that there were lots of arrows getting shot at them. Right? And Stan began pulling out the arrows as they hit him one by one. And he'd pull out an arrow, and he began proclaiming the gospel and breaking the arrows over his knees, one by one. And Stan sat there as the onslaught continued until his body was riddled with about 50 to 60 arrows. His blood
filled the river that was nearby. And when Stan finally fell, the warriors then turned to Phil. And it took almost as many arrows to kill Phil. Finally, both missionaries lay on the stony beach amid a heap of more than 200 arrows. They were later devoured by the cannibals, chopped into pieces so that their spirit wouldn't come back. But this one courageous act opened up the gospel for the Yali tribe, and today there are more than 100 gospel-believing churches within that region. Well, I'm not at all suggesting that we should become missionaries, and unless you really want to, come with me to Cambodia. But otherwise, I'm not suggesting that we go be that kind of like off-the-wall courageous. There's a few number of people that are really called into that kind of position. So we don't need to be like a Phil Masters or a Stan Deal. But maybe when we step out in Nicodemus and respond to the cross, that'll be courageous enough. Think about it. Nicodemus, he was leaving his old religion behind. He was leaving his old family ways behind. He was no doubt leaving lots of friendships behind. And I'm not saying that we just radically change and just drop all of that stuff there, but I am saying that in those areas of your life where you see the truth, and the truth is asking you to reconsider past friendships, or they're asking you to reconsider past ways, that the truth should reign out in your life. And that a truly courageous Christian will be able to constantly think about and make a conscious, brave act to step out in a way that you haven't thought about before. It will defy normal decision-making, because stepping out and following Jesus Christ is not a normal decision, right? In Matthew 22:14, for many are called, but fewer are chosen. Many people have heard about Jesus Christ, but few will actually listen and follow to him. And when we are presented in our lives with the gospel of Jesus Christ, we have an opportunity to deeply respond to that truth. And friends, today, that's what we're being called to do. We're being called to defy common thinking like Nicodemus. As Nicodemus understood the foot of the cross, as he looked at Jesus Christ and saw this man as God, he responded, and when he responded in his life, he was able to step out in a huge way that all of society would see. Let's pray. Our Lord and Savior, we are thankful for this time. Father, I ask, Lord, that you would give us this kind of courageous Christianity, Lord, that you would give us an opportunity to really consider the cross, that we would build our lives and our faith and our foundation of all thoughts and precepts upon the truth of Jesus Christ, Lord. We ask that you would shepherd our lives, Lord. Encourage us. Allow us to move forward in faith and boldness, Lord. And we ask that you would give us the kind of power that Nicodemus had in his life, Lord, as he really, truly understood the work of the cross in his life. In Jesus' name.